Second, the Indigenous sites.
You can start.
Okay.
You like to?
Yeah.
Good afternoon to all. Hello. First of all, I would like to acknowledge and pay respect to the traditional owners of the land on which we meet, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. It is upon their ancestral lands that the University of Sydney is built, as we share our knowledge, teaching, learning, and research practices within this university, may we also pay respect to the knowledge embedded forever within the Aboriginal custodianship of country. My name is Carla Guedes, and I'm a Portuguese anthropologist, volunteering in University of Sydney, working directly with Dr. Jaime Gongora. Thank you so much. And thank you all for being here today. We hope you'll enjoy not also this new Indigenous seminar, but also everything in this event, including the beautiful and conceptual presence of these two Aboriginal artwork that you could see, with whom we have so much pride and joy to share with you. I will start the order of proceedings for today, welcoming Dr. Roseanne Taylor, Dean of this faculty, that will say a few words about the Indigenous Seminar Series initiative. After that, our guest, Trevor Leaman, PhD researcher at Wiradjuri Cultural Astronomy Project, will share his knowledge and really, really interesting experience with us. Thank you, Dr. Roseanne.
Sorry. Yes, I want to say something. Is firstly say thank you very much to Carla, Liz, and Emma for helping with these seminars. Really, they are the force behind pushing people a little bit to come here. And also, I want to acknowledge the good number of medicine students with us today. It's a good number, and also people from other institutions. Thank you very much.
Well, it's a great pleasure to be here today, and of course, always a challenge to drag people in from the glorious sunshine that we're enjoying outside. But I think this is going to be a really interesting seminar, and I'd like to start just by adding my acknowledgement of the original custodians of these lands and the sharing of their knowledge that are practices that we aim to continue to this very day. And I think what we'll be hearing about in this seminar is a great example and will give us some insights into ways of seeing the world and understanding the world around us, which of course is what we're here about, you know, trying to understand the relationships between the natural world that we experience around us. For us, our particular interest is in how that impacts on animals and animal breeding patterns, animal science, and I think we're in for some for a very interesting seminar today from Trevor Leaman, who is of course from Nura, Gili over at UNSW, and we're looking forward to exploring further a range of possibilities around student projects potentially and student learning to expand our students' horizons and increase their cultural competency and awareness of some of the some of the ways in which Indigenous Australia has understood the environment in which we live. So thanks again to all who've organised the seminars and for people who are attending today. And it's my great pleasure to hand over to Trevor Leaman to get started on the seminar.
Thank you very much. And, thanks, great applause, and I haven't even started yet. I'm, as was mentioned, I'm based over at Nura, Gili, at UNSW. And what we're doing over there is building a small team of people who are looking at how Indigenous people see the night sky, so Indigenous astronomy. And by Indigenous, it's not just including the Aboriginal astronomy, but there's the Torres Strait Islander astronomy, and also more global focus as well, looking at astronomies from around the world. The talk I've got today... hands up, I presume you're all to the veterinary science students, is that correct? Or a few different faculties? Oh, that's good, that's good. I've got some sort of basic astronomy in here, so hopefully I don't sort of go too much into it. A lot of this work is basically continuing on from my master's in astronomy. I did a Master of Science in Astronomy through Swinburne Uni when I was still based in Tasmania. And I don't know if you know that course, but it's a purely online course. You can do it anywhere in the world. And I just happen to be anywhere in the world called Tasmania. So it's sort of starting to thread into what I'm doing currently, which is Wiradjuri astronomy. The Wiradjuri people, I don't know if you know, but the largest language group in New South Wales. They take up most of the central region in New South Wales. Once you go beyond the Blue Mountains, you're pretty much in Wiradjuri territory. It goes quite some ways back. And the actual area is close to twice the area of Tasmania. So when I was first offered this project, I sort of put my hands up to, yeah, I'll do it. And then I looked on the map and went, oh, great. That's a lot of area to cover. So anyway, so into the actual project itself. As I said, it's more of my master's materials coming into the Wiradjuri astronomy. A lot of this was based on my analysis of some central desert astronomy. Okay. Now the title, if you look at it carefully, down below where it says a link between animal breeding cycles and Aboriginal astronomy, I've got a question mark there. Because although we have some anecdotal evidence to suggest that the breeding cycles link to the rising and setting times of certain stars in the night sky, we're still trying to work out if that is the case across the board. So this whole study is just like a continuation of studies that have been done previously with other language groups, etc. So... I just thought before we start get into it a little bit is to just mention the word cultural astronomy. This is the area that I'm in at the moment. I have, as I said before, my master's in astronomy, which is, I suppose, the astrophysical astronomy that most people are familiar with. Cultural astronomy is, I suppose, a subset of astronomy in the sense that it's the way that people... cultures around the world throughout history have looked at night sky and have drawn their traditions from that night sky. Okay, and it's roughly divided into four, sometimes five, distinct sort of areas of research. The first one is archaeastronomy. Now, we do occasionally a little bit of this, but for most cases, it's more done in the Northern Hemisphere, where we have monuments that can be measured and the alignments can be made between those structures and the rising and setting of the moon, the sun, and sometimes even certain stars. My area is ethnoastronomy, or at least it's a much larger part of what I do, and it's looking at the astronomy of living cultures, and you can see from that definition that Aboriginal astronomy and Indigenous astronomy comes more under that sort of heading. Okay, we also do a lot of the studies on the ethnological records, because in our early past, a lot of the early Australian anthropologists would go into different regions throughout Australia, the different language groups, and record the customs and traditions of those peoples, including their astronomies. The other two little subgroups is historical astronomy. And this is, as it says, the historical part. It's the analysing the data that has been recorded of observations of the night sky. So it could be eclipses, it could be supernovae, it could be anything that was of note to those peoples, recorded it in their journals, and we can recover and analyse that material. And then we've got the history of astronomy. Sounds similar, but there's a slight sort of different focus, and it's more to do with, I'll give you an example, the recording the history of a particular observatory through time. You know, who did what at that observatory, when it was built, what it was observing, all that sort of stuff. That's the history of astronomy. Certain astronomers, historical astronomers, their lives and times sort of comes under that banner there. There is a fifth one. I didn't want to clutter this one up too much because it's just too much information. But there's also a subgroup called the history of astrology. Now, you might find that a bit bizarre that astronomers are actually studying astrology, but it's a legitimate discipline in its own right. Because, as you're probably aware, that astronomy developed in some respects from astrology, the predictive nature of where the stars and planets were in the certain sky, led to the observations of planetary movements, to astronomy, etc. So some do actually study the history of astrology as part of that cultural astronomy, because it's all to do with how we look at and relate to the night sky. So it's an important part. So anyway, as I said before, my area is ethnoastronomy, studying the astronomies of the indigenous peoples of this land. And what I want to do is just sort of give you an idea of how people from different locations, different places, view the night sky. From the Western Northern Hemisphere perspective, modern astronomers sort of look at the sky in this respect. I don't know how well that's come up on the slide there, but I have joined the dots between some of those stars there to draw up the constellations. And that's how our modern astronomy looks at the night sky. The constellations are the joining of the dots, so to speak, the joining of the stars to form this sort of thing in the night sky. The constellations as we know them. And from a Western perspective, from a Northern Hemisphere perspective in this case, with our 88 recognised constellations that modern astronomers use to divide up the night sky. As you can see, a lot of those are based on, there was a few exceptions, but a lot of those are based on mythologies, stories of how one creature being interacted with another one. And of course, they've been elevated to the skies. Now, that differs slightly in the way that the Aboriginal people see the night sky. They're not so much caught up in the joining of the dots between stars. And in fact, a lot of their constellations are actually single stars. How do you make up a constellation from a single star? Well, it's the single star itself is important to them. That becomes the animal, the creature, whatever. And that's their constellation. So that's just one way of viewing the night sky. This, I've got it as an Aboriginal night sky. This is from the Borong people. It was recorded by Stambridge in 1858. They come from the Mallee district in central northern Victoria, so around that area. So this is just one view of the night sky from one language group. And bear in mind there were 300-400 different language groups in Australia before white settlement. Each one would have their own particular astronomies, the way they see the night skies. A lot of similarities and common threads running between them, but each one could be considered slightly separate from the whole So you can't really talk of a single Aboriginal astronomy. You've actually got to say which language group you're working in. So here comes the fun part. From the anecdotal evidence that I have, I'm going to present this straight after this slide here, it seems that the star's position in the night sky is important to how, well, what animal they place onto it, the meaning behind it. And if you want to sort of do it from an analytical perspective, this is one way of sort of looking at it. So it's important that we understand, I know it's a bit tricky, and there's still some debate about the definitions here. In fact, I had Professor Clive Ruggles at Nura, Gili last week, and he's a leading authority on and archaeastronomy. He actually holds the chair in archaeastronomy from Leicester University in England. And we were going through this material here, these definitions. And even he couldn't fully agree to some of these definitions. So we basically sat down and said, well, what you do is you put down your definitions of what you think it is, and you stick with that with your analysis, and be damned with someone else's definition. So this is the definition we're working with at the moment. So, first of all, let's have a look. The first one there, heliacal rise. Now, this is the first brief. If I just sort of divide this room, just pretend this is the celestial sphere here. We've got some of the stars here. That's good. Now, if I was the north and that's the south in front of me here, so this side over here would be which direction? East, correct. So if you just imagine this part of the room here, this part is east. Over there is west. So heliacal rise would be the first appearance of a star on the eastern horizon. We'll just say that's the horizon line there. Rising above the eastern horizon just before the sunrise starts to wash out the night sky. So that's a heliacal rise. Okay, that's one of the six important positions that the stars can be in. The other one is heliacal set, which is over in the west. It's the first brief sighting of a star prior to setting in the west. So we have the sun setting, and just as it's going below the horizon, just as the sky is getting dark, suddenly the star just comes out. As you know, see all the stars starting to come out just after the sunset. It just briefly comes out just before it sets as well. So that's a heliacal set. Now the achronicle rise, it's a little bit different. Instead of the same part of the sky, we're looking opposite parts of the sky. So the achronicle rise, first sighting of a star rising in the east, just after sunset. So the sun sets, and it's the first time you ever see it appear in the night sky on the horizon before it moves across the sky. So that's an achronicle rise. Achronicle sets, the opposite. So that's another sort of aspect that's important. So it's the last sighting of a star setting in the west just before sunrise. And then we've got, just for good measure, we've got two other definitions. We've got the dawn meridional crossing, when the star crosses the meridian at dawn. So the meridian is, if you can imagine, a line running directly overhead, going pretty much due north-south. That's the meridian line. And a meridian cross is when the star just crosses that part of the sky. Whoops, we're gone. There we go. Just a Microsoft working nicely for me. There we go. Anyway, dawn meridional crossing, it crosses that line just before dawn. And of course, the M dusk, meridional crossing at dusk as sun sets. Just as the sun sets, it crosses the meridian up here as well. So they're the six important aspects that we look for in these stories, and these seem to be important to the Aboriginal people when they assign a certain creature, animal, to a particular star that makes up their night sky. Now, after doing that huge sort of description of how the sky moves. The first example I'm going to give you here is, it doesn't quite fit any of those descriptions. It's close. It still occurs at dusk, but instead of a constellation which is a single star, it is the entire Milky Way, and it's the orientation of the Milky Way which is important. Now, if you're not quite familiar what the Milky Way is, I don't know if you guys have never ventured out of Sydney into the dark skies at night and seen the band of the Milky Way up there. Basically, it's just our viewpoint of our position in the spiral arm of the Milky Way galaxy, looking through those dust lanes and the stars that make up the spiral arms. So that there is the brightest part of the Milky Way, right near the tail of Scorpio. Now, the Southern Cross is in the upper right corner, and you can see the bands running from upper right to lower left. Now, to the Aboriginal people, and this is quite common throughout all language groups throughout Australia, through the Aboriginal Australia, there is an emu in there. It's called the emu in the sky. Can anyone see it? No? Okay, I'll give you a clue. In the upper right, right next to the Southern Cross, is that dark little patch. That is the head of the emu. It's also called the Coal Sack Nebula in the modern astronomical view of the night sky. That's the head of the emu. Can anyone see the rest of the body of the emu? Bonus points if you get it. No, you can't get it. Okay. I might just come out here with the laser. It might be easier to see. Okay. There's the head right up here. This is the Southern Cross up here. If you go down, here's the neck. Here's the body right here. And the legs stretch off down here. So that entire band of the Milky Way there is the emu in the sky. Very, very important. Orientation is very, very important because in a certain position, and this is pretty close to it, if you saw that the Milky Way rising in the night sky just after sunset, so that we're on dusk here now, that would tell the Aboriginal people that the emu eggs are ready to harvest, if it was in that position. This is about August, okay, in the night sky. They saw the Milky Way in that position in August. Emu eggs are ready. Emu eggs are a very valuable food source, high in protein. You know how big an emu egg is? Yeah, there's a good half dozen or more ordinary chicken eggs in one of those things. And they would look at that in the night sky and go, okay, time for the emu eggs. Let's go and collect them. And they didn't collect all of them, they always left a few behind because they want to keep the generations ticking over. And in fact, if you go up to Ku'ringai Chase National Park, there's a rock carving up there on the ground, which is thought to represent the emu in the sky at that position. In fact, the left-hand photograph was taken by Barnaby Norris, who was Ray Norris's son. Took the photo, managed to superimpose it with the Milky Way behind it. And when the orientation of the Milky Way in the sky matched the orientation of the emu on the ground in that rock carving, that's around about August. And it's almost as though they're saying, if you see the Milky Way, the same way it is drawn on the ground, in the sky, the emu's ready. The emu eggs are ready. Later on in the year, just after sunset, as the sky rotates through the year, position starts to shift. So by about September, October, that orientation's changed. Doesn't match the one on the ground. Too late to collect the emu eggs. And there's one other factor, the emu, and that is as it keeps rotating through the sky, when the head of the emu is pretty much pointing straight down, the body and the head pointing straight down, that was the time that the boys were initiated into men. The symbolism here is that it is the male emus They don't lay the eggs, obviously, the females do. It's a bit science. The males actually raise the chicks. They actually sit and incubate the eggs and raise the chicks. So it's symbolic of that initiation of the boys being raised by the men to be future leaders of their group. So there's that nice little connection. You've got the food and a cultural reference all in that one. So anyway, we'll move on to the next. Here's another one, and this is an insect. This is ants and ant larvae. There's a whole story based around this. This comes from that Borong area, that language group I was telling you about before in the Mallee district of Victoria. Now, there's a story about this woman called Mara Pienkirk, who was able to save her group, her family, from starvation during a huge, prolonged drought. There was absolutely no food around and people were starving. And one day she'd almost totally given up. And it's basically just sitting on the ground, you know, just waiting for death to come upon her, I suppose, in a way. And she noticed some ants trailing off along the ground. And she thought, I'll see where these ants are going. She followed them and then went down a hole. So she dug down to see where they were going, and she uncovered an ant's nest full of these larvae. And in her desperation for food, I suppose, she started to eat them. She grabbed handfuls of these ant larvae and started to eat them. And pretty much immediately she felt she was recovering from, you know, that starvation. And she thought, well, you know, I'll tell the rest of my family this. This might just get them through the drought sort of thing. And it's from that that she eventually saved the whole group from eventual starvation. And for that, she was later placed into the night sky upon her passing. And she became the star Arcturus. It's a nice orange-red giant star in the northern sky. From our perspective, it's in the northern part of the sky, but we can still see it from down here. It just so happens that star, when it crosses the meridian at dusk, so after sunset, just crossing the meridian, in late July, that's when the ant larvae are ready to harvest. And so for that reason, that's why she has been attributed to that star, because she's the one that saved them from starvation. So that has become the star known as Mara Pienkirk, and its symbol, its totemic symbol, is an ant. And you'll see that drawn on star charts from that Latin language group. So there's that connection, stars, particular orientation in the sky, particular time, a certain animal or a food source, in this case, it was available for them. Mallee fowl, again from the same language group. It's one of those that, I don't know if you're familiar, so it builds its nest and incubates the eggs in the nest, the mound. The mound keeps them warm, and they eventually hatch and move on. And it's related, they've attributed the star Bega to the Mallee fowl, Mallee hen. And there's anecdotal evidence that suggests that it's linked, or the reason why it's been given to Vega is that it's a chronicle rise in early August. It's the same time the eggs are laid by the Mallee fowl. And then by the heliacal set, which occurs a couple of months later, early November, those eggs hatch. So if they saw that star Vega in the night sky crossing, doing the chronicle rise, they know the eggs are available, and again, they can use that as a food source, and they know by the heliacal set of that star, it's too late because the eggs are hatched. There are chicks running around. So. And orchid migrations along the east coast of Australia seem to be linked to the Pleiades, Seven Sisters. There's a lot of rock art along the coast here where if you look at them, they're either whales or orcas. And there's some, again, evidence to suggest that when you see the Seven Sisters, the Pleiades, in their heliacal rise, rising just before dawn in June, July,
That's when the northerly migrations of the whales come up. So they've been linked. Seven Sisters, the Orca migrations. So when they saw that on the horizon, they knew the whales were coming up and the orcas were coming up. And dingoes. Ooh, picture's missing. Anyway, you know what dingoes look like. Again, central desert area. This time it's going inland now. And the reason for the title of the my talk is that there is evidence to suggest that when the Seven Sisters were seen to rise in June, July, first sighting just before sunrise, that's when the dingo pups were ready. Now, dingoes were very, very important to the Central Desert Aboriginal peoples because, A, they provided warmth throughout a campfire because it gets damn cold in the Central Desert region in winter. I don't know if you've been out there in winter. It goes below freezing. So they used dingoes as warmth to keep warm. They will snuggle up to a dingo. Also, the dingoes were a food source in times of need. Not necessarily all the time, but in times when things were scarce, dingoes were a source of food to them. So it's very, very important to know when the dingoes are breeding, and they've linked that to the helical rise of the Pleiades, Seven Sisters. So there's a few sort of anecdotal accounts of the stars and some asterisms and Pleiades that sort of indicate that they were looking at the breeding cycles of particular animals, linking them to the stars, the appearance of stars on the horizon, and attributing those stars to that animal. Now I'm going to go into some of the work that I was doing previously as part of my master's, and still continuing because it's going to slowly thread into what I'm doing now with the Wiradjuri astronomy too. And this is the work of Daisy Bates. Anyone familiar with Daisy Bates' story? Okay. Well, she was born in Ireland, 1859. She emigrated to Australia the first time, 1883. She went back to England, come back again. And she was a busy lady. You're going to love this. She married three times, bigamously. Back in the days when there's very little communication between the Australian colonies, she managed to get away with this. First of all, she married an Edwin Morant, which later turned out to be the same Breaker Morant that we know from Australian history. And she married him 1884, Charters Towers, Queensland. And then wandered off, got married again in Nura to Jack Bates, hence the name Daisy Bates. That's where her surname came from. She was I can't remember what her maiden name was. But anyway, then she came to Sydney soon after marrying Jack Bates, visited a friend who happened to be on the ship that was just docked in Sydney, and decided to get married again. He was already married at the time too. So that's, anyway, that's an aside to the interesting life and times of Daisy Bates. But later on, she became an amateur anthropologist based in Western Australia, Perth, and then gradually moved into South Australia. And she became an honorary protector of Aborigines in 1912. That was just a nice way for the South Australian government to sort of give her a title, unpaid title, by the way, so that she had some sort of recognition for what she was doing. All voluntary, of course. Things haven't changed, have they? And then she settled eventually in Ooldea, which is known as Ooldea Gabby, from 1919 to 1935. She was quite elderly by this stage. She was, what, 60-ish? Going on into her 70s. So moving into Ooldea. So Ooldea is, it's, I don't know if you can see it up there, but it's the one sort of in red, highlighted in red. And it became, it's just at the time, it was just a siding, a railway siding for the Transcontinental Railway running through over the Nullarbor Plains. But it was also, you see in the lower right picture, That's called Ooldea soak, and it was a permanent water source and an important meeting point for a lot of the Central Desert Aboriginal peoples from all over Australia, all assembled there for huge ceremonies. So it was a good place for her to set up and observe their culture and record their stories. And among the stories, as you'll see later, were some of the star stories. So there we are. She's now set up at Ooldea. This little description here from her journal and also in her book, describing how she set up a tent and basically lived there for 16 years in the desert at Ooldea, just observing the comings and goings of people, the Aboriginal people, who she befriended, many of them, she was entrusted with looking after a lot of ceremonial objects too. So she managed to develop quite a strong rapport with the local Indigenous population there. And one of the things she also did, and she describes how she was interested in astronomy as a kid, and there's anecdotal evidence that when she was in Ireland as a kid, she was taken to one of the major observatories at the time. So I'm sure that's where her interest in astronomy developed. So here she is. She's there now recording these stories. One of the stories she recorded, and it's a subject of one of the papers that just came out recently, was a story based around the constellation Orion, Taurus, and again the Seven Sisters. But surrounding those constellations, there were other objects, other animals, other stars related to those animals. And this is a list that I managed to recover from her archived notes. And as you can see, most of them relate to stars. There's three there that relate to the planets Mars, Venus and Jupiter. If we just ignore those planets there and just look at the stars alone, and this is where the analysis side comes into it, what I've done here is basically, and apologies for all these tables and things, I don't expect you to memorise, I'm just showing you how the analysis side of things were done and still continuing at the moment. Of those stars that relate to the animals in their night sky, this is the Ooldean night sky from northern South Australia, central South Australia. You look at the aspects, the chronicle rise, sets, M dusk, meridional dusk times there. And the same again with the heliacal rise, set, and M dawn. And then take that data, that astronomical data, and compare it with the breeding cycles of those animals that the stars represent. Now, unfortunately, I couldn't reproduce the chart that I have, which looks something like this. I've colour-coded it to show the breeding cycles through the year of each of those animals and where these astronomical aspects come. So unfortunately, the next table is a little bit cluttered, but I'll go through it a little bit just to sort of describe what I've done here. Now, in this region, from this group of Aboriginal people, they saw the dingo mother as the star Arkanar. Now, we already know that the dingo pups, the breeding cycles relates to the rising of the Pleiades, so we'll leave that out for now. But the mother has been ascribed the star Arkanar. So going through the mating breeding cycles, etc., of dingoes and how they relate to the different aspects of where the star could be in the night sky, it was a little bit difficult to actually pinpoint how the star Arkanar relates to dingo mother in this case, because unbeknownst to us, we've actually got confirmation from one of our colleagues that happens to live in Alice Springs, who is an ecologist out there, basically said that dingoes actually breed all year round. There's no, however, there is a peak in their breeding cycle, and that peak does occur pretty much when the Pleiades is rising, in the heliacal rise. Also, when Arkanar is in heliacal rise too, I've highlighted, I've bolded the HR in that first line there with Dingo Mother. So there is sort of a match, but not quite, because of the complex nature of the breeding cycles. There's no just definitive, this is when they breed, this is how it relates to the star. This one's more like this is the peak in the breeding cycle, and it happens to relate to the helical rise of Arcana in this case. Same with the birthing, occurs around about the helical set, that's when that peak occurs. Again, it's all year round, so hard to match. And also the whelping occurs in the meridional dawn for that particular star. So we don't. It's a little hard to sort of say one or the other. That's a definite match, but it's close enough if you just look at the peak breeding cycle rather than the actual year long general trend. Okay. And the similar things can be said for some of the others. One I want to point out to you is the raven and the raven chicks, the crow chicks. One is the adult, one's it was represented by the star Ooldea. And the chicks are represented by an asterism or a constellation that we recognise in our western night sky as the constellation of Delphinus Dolphin. Now, there is a sort of a match between those two because they actually appear in the same part of the sky, pretty close to the same part of the sky anyway, so that you'd expect them to rise and set pretty much the same time. So there's a nice sort of interrelationship between those two constellations. And it seems like the raven is relating to the somewhere between the conical set and the conical rise in that period. It's when the mating and breeding starts, and also through the birth and the hatching and all that sort of stuff, that move a couple of aspects along. So there's some matches, but not as definitive as we'd like. And we're sort of wondering, and we're still doing, we're still processing, we're still doing the data at the moment, asking all sorts of questions. Are we looking at it the right way? Are we overthinking it, as we do sometimes? And there are a couple of other aspects that we probably need to take into account when we start matching the stars and the animals and the breeding cycles of those animals. And one of the complications is the precession of the equinoxes. I'm sorry, I'm going to go into a bit more astronomy here, unfortunately, because we need to understand this process of how over about 26,000 years, the Earth's axial tilt moves in an arc like this. And as it moves in an arc, the rising and setting positions and times of those constellations change as well. So although we might have a good match with a star and a breeding cycle of an animal now, in the past history it wouldn't be true. In the future it wouldn't be true either. They would slowly sort of... There's a window of when they do match. And one of the reasons why some of those don't match in our little table is that some of those stories of that star related to the animal might be more than 2,000 years old. And the position of that star has moved over that time. So that's something we've got to look at. Okay? And of course into the future too. Interestingly enough, and this is a good example of this, is you remember when I mentioned the emu in the sky and its position, orientation like this, matching the time when the emu eggs are available. That's true now. But if you went back 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, it wouldn't match. Okay? You go back, go forward a couple of thousand years, and it won't match again. So it seems as though that particular story, and that in the rock art it's representing, that position of the Milky Way, is current for now. So we could say that particular rock carving up in Kurangai Chase may be no more than 2,000 years old, maybe less than 2,000 years. And it just so happens to match right now the current breeding cycles of emus. So extrapolating from that, we can say that some of the matches and some of the mismatches we have may be because of this movement of the stars and the stories not changing or yet to change or have changed depending on circumstances. So a lot of what we're hypothesising is that the constellations, the stars at the moment, match some of the stories. And some of those stories probably, at least, they're probably 2,000 years old. If you go back even further in time, they would have allocated and attributed a different star to the same animal because the rising time matches the breeding cycle of the animal at that time. And over time, as the Earth moves on its axis, different stars rise and set at different times. They'll move the constellation of the animal to a different star, because that star now rises at the right time. So it's an interesting sort of concept. It's a sort of living, almost like the animals they represent, I suppose, that the whole story is not fixed in time, in a particular time frame. It does move with time. So that's complication one. And there's another representation of that axial movement of the Earth over time. You can see that currently, Polaris, if you look at the Northern Hemisphere, I haven't got the Southern Hemisphere one here, unfortunately, but the Northern Hemisphere Polaris is the pole star at the moment. If you go back in time, or even forward in time, to the opposite side, Virgo would be the pole star. So you can just imagine as the pole point in the night sky shifts, so that all the other constellations, etc., move over time. So that's the first complication we have to incorporate into the whole story. Second complication is climate change. I mean, we're all familiar with climate change happening now through our sort of intervention, but past climate change too. And we know that the breeding cycles of animals closely match with climate, so that the current breeding patterns that we see in the animals may have been slightly different going back 4, 5, 12,000, 20,000 years. So that's another factor we have to sort of incorporate into whether we can relate that animal's breeding cycle with that star. We have to look at the influence of the climate on the breeding cycles of those animals too. So it's an ongoing process. It's still got a long way to go yet. As I said, what we're hoping to do, I think I'll just bring this up. What we're hoping to do is to see if we can come up with some sort of algorithm, some sort of program that if we just punch in the stars, rising, setting times, the meridional transits, etc., into a program, and then put in the breeding cycles of particular animals into that, and see whether it will actually give us a matrix of similarity to certain stars, and see if those stars actually match the breeding cycles of the animals that they represent, so that we can use it not just for the central desert region, in this case with the Ooldean astronomy, but also with my project with the Wiradjuri astronomy, with other astronomies throughout Australia, and see if we can sort of not only relate it to current similarities, but also whether we can actually predict what the constellations of the stars would have been representing in past history too, see if we can sort of match some of the older attributes to those stars as well. So a lot of work to go through, a lot of work to do. What I'll do is I'll just finish up there. I'll just give you a few of the references, some of the information I managed to sort of pull in material from. And hopefully the next slide will come up. Yes! Nothing like self-promotion, isn't it? So if you want to know more, just get your smartphones out and scan those there, and it'll take you to our Indigenous Astronomy website, and a bit more information on the Indigenous Astronomy team at U New South Wales. So with that, I think I'll finish. Okay. Thank you. And questions?
Thank you, Trevor, for your amazing talk. And now if somebody has some questions, just please raise your hand.
I'm sure I left a lot out, so.
For the species species that's got quite a large distribution and migration, such as the orca. I think they're located like pretty much worldwide, essentially. Is there any logic to sort of correlating the Australian documented astrological like science of migration with the culture such as Native American?
That would be good, actually. That's a good point. I'm sure someone's done it somewhere. I haven't actually gone into that, but I've specifically looked at the East Coast Australia migrations, and because we know that correlation exists. But that's an important and very interesting point, is to see if you find a similar match between the migrations in other parts of the world too. There's bound to be some link somewhere, I'm sure, but yeah. We just know that in Australia, in the case of the East Coast Australia, they do seem to have linked with the heliacal rise of the Seven Sisters of Pleiades.
I stopped this because I guess it would be hard to find, in some cases, like a lot of anecdotal evidence, and perhaps using it from other cultures would be beneficial as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I know there's a strong whale culture in North America too, on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be good actually to see if that matches too. That might be a future project for another student. We're always looking for more students.
I've heard before that dingoes were introduced somewhat recently to Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And would you expect then that there would be a higher match of the constellation because it would have been possible to
You're right. And that would actually support the fact that the current link between the heliacal rise of Pleiades and the dingo breeding cycle is recent. It's a recent match of the last 2,000, 3,000 odd years. When dingoes were introduced to Australia, I think I read recently that they keep pushing back the date when dingoes were actually introduced, and I think it was some dates being pushed back to almost to the last ice age. So we can say dingoes may have been in Australia for the last 12,000 years. But we sort of know anecdotally that the match between the breeding cycles as we know them now seem to match the heliacal rise now. So we can say that that's probably been around for at least 2,000 years. So if we go further back in history, it might have been something else. Another star might have been related to dingoes. And that's something we've got to try and unearth. Yeah.
Do you think so? Are you able to draw on oral histories and song lines, I guess,
Well, as you probably know, the Seven Sisters song line is quite extensive across Australia. So, there's probably, dingoes, okay, we've got the anecdotal evidence, and it was Tyndale actually recorded this back in the 1950s, the match between the rising of the Pleiades and the dingo breeding cycle in the central desert. So if you actually go down the song line, you'd expect that to change slightly depending on the breeding pattern. I know, as I said before, that the breeding cycle seems to be yearly, but there's a peak. So whether that's the same in other parts of Australia with dingoes, I'm not quite sure. But and whether it still matches the rising of the Seven Sisters, or it's given something totally different. The story that I've worked on with the Daisy Bates archives, so moving down from Central Australia down to more into South Australia, Central South Australia with the Ooldea and stuff, is that the story surrounding Orion, Taurus and the Seven Sisters, the dingo puppies are actually ascribed the stars that we think are the stars that make up Orion's shield, the shield stars as we call them. So, which is close to the Pleiades, they sort of rise about the same time too, so, but they've shifted the story to these stars, not the Pleiades. So whether that you can continue down the song line and see whether there's a match or a mismatch, be really, really interesting as future work, definitely. Yeah.